All the PCB electromagnets shown in this video were manufactured by PCBWay. Check out PCBWay.com for all your prototyping needs. Thanks for sponsoring this video. PCB electromagnets are the holy grail of ferrofluid displays, which is a large part of what we do on this channel. The idea of embedding electromagnets into a printed circuit board is extremely appealing to us because it would allow us to remove a ton of wiring and make infinitely more organized circuitry. On this channel, we've already made a 252 electromagnet ferrofluid display, which took us weeks to get wired up, and we still ended up with a horrible rat's nest that's basically impossible to debug. On top of that, each electromagnet costs like a couple dollars, and when you multiply that with 252, it just gets extremely expensive. Because of all this, we frequently get questions in the comment section about why we don't use PCB electromagnets, and the answer is honestly depressingly simple. They just aren't strong enough. We've never actually tested this ourselves, but we've watched all the videos of our resident YouTube PCB coil guru, Carl Begea, and they make it quite clear that there's not a lot of magnetic force generated by such coils. A few years ago, he even made a video that basically answered all of our burning questions as he literally tested his coils with ferrofluid. And the results were as expected. But we still really love the idea, and we thought maybe there still are some use cases for PCB electromagnets in ferrofluid displays, even if we can't directly swap out our normal electromagnets in our large display that requires us to lift ferrofluid vertically. So we reached out to Carl way back then with our ideas on how to improve the magnetic field strength, like for example adding an iron core, which he had obviously already thought about, but couldn't find a way to make practical and efficient. But this summer, Carl suddenly got back to us saying, "Hey, do you guys still work on your ferrofluid display? Because I think with some adjustments to my PCB coils, we can make it work." Let's go, everybody, our first collab. Because there's two labs. I'll see myself out. What Carl had discovered was that adding iron behind the electromagnet was a good trade-off for his design. It meant that he didn't have to waste any turns in the coil to fit an iron core in the middle, but it still gave an increase in the magnetic field. And as a bonus, it even acts as a heat sink, which allows him to overdrive the coils without accidentally starting a fire. You probably thought I was joking, right? So he sent us a package with what we needed to test this concept with some ferrofluid. So that's what we did. And it didn't work, like, at all. We even tried to overdrive the magnets to more than twice the rated voltage and slowly slide some ferrofluid across it, but yeah, still nothing. It didn't even break. Coincidentally, we were working on another concept around the time Carl contacted us. That meant this wasn't a total disaster. We were experimenting with what in technical terms may be called adding a DC bias to the electrically controlled magnetic field, but in layman's terms it's called placing a normal magnet behind the electromagnet. If done correctly, you can basically add a background magnetic field that is just slightly too weak to lift the ferrofluid by itself, but when you turn on the electromagnet, it has a lot more oomph than it would have without the permanent magnet behind it. If you combine this concept with a PCB coil, you get an entirely new type of ferrofluid actuator, one that's slightly less versatile than a normal electromagnet, but can be made much smaller and will probably consume less power. One application that I can think of for such an actuator is to make a ferrofluid music visualizer, and this is an idea that's been very popular on YouTube and Kickstarter lately. In that scenario, it's not even necessary to tweak the permanent magnetic field to not lift ferrofluid on its own, because it's more interesting if you have a bigger blob of ferrofluid at all times. And the only thing that's necessary to make an interesting visual is to modulate the permanent magnetic field with the adjustable field from the coil. To make things even more interesting, Carl had some ideas on his own. He wanted to optimize the copper trace thickness and add more layers to his design. So he took his two-layer design and added one. Like, in front of the number two. Carl made the 12-layer PCB coil! You need to go check out this video once you're done with this one. And if you're as excited as I am to see this in action, then now is a good time to start holding your breath, because he sent us another package. Look at that! That's so much more like it! It's still not quite as powerful as a normal electromagnet, and it can't lift this ferrofluid vertically, but it's so close! However excited I was to test these out, I must admit, I wasn't really expecting these to work either. But the best part about all of this is that we haven't even tested them on our homemade ferrofluid tank yet. You see, the reason Carl sent us all of these, instead of just buying some ferrofluid online and testing it himself, isn't just because we got some nice open source magnet controller circuitry from our previous projects, but mainly because we got a huge homemade tank with some highly buoyant ferrofluid compared to what you can typically buy in the stores. We have detailed exactly how we made that tank in our previous videos, and we've shared everything we know, so be sure to check that out if this is your first time here. The key to making a good ferrofluid container is to use a suspension liquid that prevents the ferrofluid from staining all the walls. The other option is to evolve an ability to look through an oily, ink-like substance, but that's only for the most dedicated among us. The proprietary suspension liquids used in most high-quality displays you can get online is not very buoyant at all compared to the ridiculously simple liquid that we used, which was salt water. There are some trade-offs with using salt water, mainly that our ferrofluid has coagulated a bit more than most of the commercial displays that we have, but our display is still half-decent even though it's been more than 2 years since we made it, and I'm not sure who writes the rules, but I think it's only humans that are allowed to disregard 2020. So let's start by testing a clean 12-layer board with no iron behind it. Look at it go! It's so damn close! We're overdriving this board quite a lot, by the way. Our circuitry is designed for 12 volts and the PCBs are designed for 5. So we don't want to keep them running for too long without the iron heatsink / field intensifier. Perfect segue. Yes! It lifts the ferrofluid! Admittedly, not a lot of ferrofluid, but it actually works. It even works with a pulsing voltage, which is the concept we use when we want to reduce the magnetic field strength of an electromagnet. No background magnet necessary for this. Kind of does make you wonder how much better that would work though. Perfect segue again! That is pretty cool. Although, the ferrofluid is drooping quite a bit because we weren't able to center the electromagnet on the iron cylinder due to the cables being in our way. The iron cylinder could also have been a tad smaller as the permanent magnet's field lines are being guided towards the circumference of the cylinder, so it would have been better if these edges could have been behind the PCB. The concept of permanent bias can even make these things work on the not very buoyant commercial ferrofluid tanks you can get online, so there's totally an awesome project hiding these things for those who can get their hands on them. And I'm hearing some rumors that Carl is considering to sell an improved version of the 12-layer PCB coil on his web store for a totally reasonable price, so might want to keep an eye out for those details. In the end, there's still a lot more oomph in the non-PCB electromagnets. Yeah, you heard me, these are definitely strong enough to be called electromagnets instead of just coils, but the non-PCB electromagnets come in a much larger variety of sizes and configurations. Plus, you can just make one by coiling up some random wire you have at home. So the PCB magnets, not gonna eliminate the need for any of that just yet. Additionally, you can't really use these in large vertical displays like what we want to do. But as already mentioned, I do get some ideas for more compact systems where these could definitely shine. So for us and Fetch, the best solution to reduce our wiring chaos would probably be to get hold of some non-PCB electromagnet with stiff leads that can be soldered to a PCB like through-hole components. But we haven't found a source for that, so if you have any leads, let us know down in the comment section. Alright, that's it. It's been a true pleasure to collaborate with Carl on this one and spin ideas back and forth. So please remember to go check out his video on how he's been optimizing his PCB coil design to maximize magnetic field strength. He'll cover why that's an insanely difficult design requirement, and he'll also test some other designs that I won't have time to cover here. You'll find a link in the end card that pops up in a few seconds and down in the details. While you're there, consider clicking like, and until next time, happy procrastinating!